you can't solve climate change. And these are the words that my engineering prof told me when he found out about my startup. I said, what do you mean? And he said it again, you can't solve climate change. I realized there's three possible reasons that he would have said this. One, he believes that climate change is a hoax. Two, he believes that climate change is too big to be solved by a human. Or three, he believes that climate change is too big to be solved by me. Now, I'm not going to tell you that an individual can single-handedly solve the climate crisis, but I hope that by the end of this talk, you're going to be more convinced that you as an individual have enormous power to change the future of the planet, to influence the future of the planet. And I'll even go a step further to say that the future health of the planet and the species that we share it with depend on actions by individuals like you and me to take it into our own hands. And I'll tell you how. So let's take a look at the problem. I live in Toronto, Canada, and here winters are getting warmer. We're getting mid-winter heat waves. Spring is coming sooner, and summers are getting hotter, longer, and drier. In fact, 2020 was tied with 2016 as the hottest year on record, globally, according to NASA. Now let's zoom out. Imagine you're in the vacuum of space. Everywhere you look around you, it's barren, it's inhospitable. Imagine you're put on a rocky planet, like Mars, for example. Every rock and grain of Martian dust is completely void of life. In fact, it's the same story everywhere that we look in the solar system. As far as we know, at this point in 2021, Earth is the only place that contains life. Not only that, but it's where we evolved, and we've adapted to it fantastically. The atmosphere shields the most harmful solar radiation. The magnetic field shields us from solar storms. The air is rich in oxygen. The gravity at sea level is 1G. Couldn't be more perfectly suited for human life. And relative to anything else that we see in the solar system, the Earth is an oasis. And I think it's important to look at it in that way. Now, when I'm standing on the surface and I look up at the atmosphere, it is a vast body that seemingly extends forever. But from the point of view of, say, the International Space Station, you can just see how remarkably thin the atmosphere really is. Say you magically place a road on the surface of the Earth that extends perpendicular up into space. Ignoring the laws of physics, if you drive on this road at a comfortable 100 kilometers an hour or 60 miles per hour, you'll reach space within 1 hour. Not only that, but you'll pass through about 80% of the atmosphere within 15 minutes. So I hope that just gives you a picture for just how thin the atmosphere really is. Now the CO2 concentration, the global atmospheric CO2 concentration at the time of this talk is 416.75 parts per million. For reference, over the last 800,000 years, there hasn't been one point where we've passed 300 parts per million. This is taken from ice samples in polar regions. One study by Nature suggests that the last time CO2 was over 400 parts per million was during the mid-Pliocene era, about 3.3 million years ago, where at its highest, sea levels were up to 20 meters higher than they are today. This was caused by significant melting of the Greenland and Antarctic ice sheets. Amsterdam, Miami, the whole of Bangladesh would have been underwater, except for a small portion. Choose your favorite coastal city. 50 million years ago, there were alligators and tortoises in the Arctic Circle. So the Earth has been warmer, the Earth can get warmer, and the Earth is getting warmer. Although the Earth has had natural and gradual fluctuations in temperature over the eons, the warming that is happening today is for another reason. So imagine you look at a graph. You have time in the x-axis, and you have CO2, and you have global temperature rise in the other axis. You can see a direct correlation between CO2 emissions from about 150 years ago up to today. Kind of looks like this, and it's going nowhere but up. There's a resounding agreement within the scientific community that humans are the cause of the warming that we're seeing today. So now that this is clear, we have a problem. Thank you. I'm joking. Now let's talk about solutions. We need to get to net zero carbon emissions by 2050. According to the IPCC, or the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, countries around the world are going to need to decarbonize significantly in order to prevent a 1.5 degrees Celsius warming. They've chosen 1.5 degrees Celsius because it is shortly before the point where we're going to have feedback loops, or a tipping point, which is where warming will cause more warming, which will in turn cause more warming. And this is the point that we don't want to cross. So we're going to set a metric at ourselves at 1.5 degrees Celsius by 2050. Preventing a warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius is going to require mass innovation. The entire technological structure of our society is intrinsically linked to fossil fuels. This is going to require mass innovation in all major carbon emitting sectors. Energy production and distribution, transportation, agriculture, heating and cooling units, material production, especially concrete and steel, and of course, pulling excess carbon out of the atmosphere that already exists. This is going to be hard, and I predict it's going to be the global challenge of the 21st century. But the good news is that countries around the world have now recognized and are seriously committed to solving this problem. In 2015, 191 countries signed COP21, or the Paris Agreement, legally binding them to reduce their emissions drastically to prevent a 1.5 degrees Celsius warming above pre-industrial levels by 2050. With commitment comes financial investment. In Biden's climate and environmental justice proposal, the U.S. will contribute $1.7 trillion over the next 10 years to a clean energy economy plan. Now, of course, political commitments have a flaky track record and they need to be followed through, but the point here is that money is now being allocated towards climate solutions and on a colossal scale. It's never been seen before. Now let's talk about startups. In recent years, there are startups that have gone from inception to a $1 billion valuation within 3 years. There's other startups that have reached 1 billion users global wide within 5 years. And I believe that this is going to be surpassed soon. Startups grow unfathomably fast in 2021. Let me mention a few global reaching startups that are spearheading the climate fight. Burgers for meat lovers made entirely from plants. Fully electric vehicles for basically anyone. CO2 infused cement that makes an even stronger concrete product. Or seaweed infused cattle feed that reduces methane emissions by about 80%. And my company, we use drones to plant trees. By scaling reforestation, we scale carbon sequestration. And since trees are the most effective means that we currently have of pulling carbon out of the atmosphere, this is where we're making our dent on the climate crisis. We set a midterm goal of planting 1 billion trees by 2028, but we don't plan to stop there. Not too long ago, in summer 2019, with an idea and enough insanity to give it a shot, we strapped a paintball gun to a drone, and with a cooler, we were shooting frozen gelatin-covered pods filled with soil mix and tree seeds into the grass in my friend's backyard. We got our proof of concept. We launched a Kickstarter campaign, and the company took off. Since then, our tech has changed drastically, and we're now scheduled to plant hundreds of thousands of trees across the country, partnered with some of Canada's largest forestry companies. Soon, we're going to be moving internationally. Last December, we had a few job postings, and we received over 700 applicants for a few engineering positions. My experience in this company over the last 2 years has taught me a few things. One, people care. They want to do something. They just don't know where to put their energy. Two, startups grow unfathomably fast in 2021. And three, individuals like you and me have a seriously disproportionate influence on the future of the planet. So to bring this full circle, let's put any lingering climate debate behind us. Humans are responsible for the climate crisis that we're in today. We have in the order of decades, not centuries, to figure this out. And that puts a lot of responsibility on us, on our generation, to create the future of the planet that we want. I envision this as a future that is sustainable. And by sustainable, that means one that will last. And I find that extremely exciting. By joining or starting a climate-driven company with an audacious goal, you can play a key role in creating that future. Some good questions to ask are, what are some alternatives to this carbon-intensive process that don't currently exist? How could this technology be electrified? In the words of Jocko, how do you get up before 5 a.m.? You get up before 5 a.m. In my words, how do you do something about the climate? You do something about the climate. I'll leave you with this thought. You have the power to take an idea in your head and make it real. If you do this, the future will thank you. Thank you.